For a few months now for their worship session that they're going to have this morning. So I want to invite them up. They're going to come up here and they're going to sing with us this morning. They're going to lead us, and it's going to be a good Christmas morning. You can stay seated if you want for the first two songs, and I'll invite you to stand with us later on.
This is how the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law, and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord has said through the prophet: "The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel," which means God is with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate with their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus.
Come on, he found. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth, peace to those on whom his favor rests."
To the Lord, the God of Israel, because he has come to his people and redeemed them. He has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he said through his holy prophets of long ago, salvation from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to show mercy to our ancestors and to remember his holy covenant, the oath he swore to our father Abraham, to rescue us from the hand of our enemies and to enable us to serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all our days.
Come, O come, Emmanuel. Praise God. Am I on? I think so. We're good. Amen. God is good. Amen. This is a great congregation. I thought Christmas morning, everybody's going to stay at home. this is my family stayed at home, okay? But we're here. Praise God. Well, this is wonderful. This is excellent. You know, the passages I was going to read, I think they read most all of them this morning, which is great. Either the song or the scripture verses that you read. I'm going to read part of out of Luke chapter 1. It wasn't initially in my reading, but in the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a village in Galilee, to a virgin named Mary. She was engaged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of King David. Gabriel appeared to her and said, "Greetings, favored woman, the Lord is with you." Confused and disturbed, as you can imagine, Mary tried to think what the angel could mean, and the angel said, "Don't be afraid, Mary." Almost every time when an angel appears, the first words are, "Don't be afraid," or "Fear not." "For you have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son. You'll name him Jesus. He'll be very great. He'll be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor David, and he will reign over Israel forever. This kingdom will never end." And Mary asked the angel, "Well, how can this happen? I'm a virgin. I'm not even married yet." And the angel replied, "The Holy Spirit," let me just share, "the Holy Spirit is amazing." You know, it was interesting. When I first became a believer in Christ, I met Jesus Christ and I knew God was my Father, but I didn't understand the work of the Holy Spirit. Now, I'm going to share something, and whether we believe this or not, what I'm about to tell you, the truth of it is true. Because there's a gentleman I heard preaching once, and he's a wild, crazy preacher, and he had claimed that the Lord took him to heaven, okay, and then brought him back. But while he was, so I'm listening to a story in heaven, can this be real? And anyway, he gets to a point, and I forgot who he was talking to, Abraham or Peter or somebody, and they're about to send him back to earth. And he said, well, before I go, he says, "You know, I met and I talked with Jesus, And he says, and I saw the throne where the Father was. And he knew the Father was there. He could see like the pinky or something like that. And then he asked, I think it was Peter. He said, well, where's the Holy Spirit? And Peter said, on earth. And Peter goes, oh, I knew that. But I think sometimes we forget that. The Holy Spirit is here. The Holy Spirit now indwells believers. The Holy Spirit actually leads and guides us into all truth, teaches us all things. And I thought the Holy Spirit was like a cloud or a mist. The Holy Spirit's a person. And if you will listen, the Holy Spirit will speak to you and direct you. You know, I remember when my bride, and I've shared this before, watch this, because I wasn't preaching on this. Okay, this is just bonus, so you can take this in. So watch this. But my bride, we have 6 children, okay, 3 boys, 3 girls. And they're 16, 14, 12, 10, 8, and 4. So they really like Christmas. So anyway, but when we only had our first 4 children and we were homeschooling, 2 of the children were old enough to go to a homeschool co-op. The other 2 children were still in car seats, baby seats, in a van. And this one day that there was a co-op at a church, my bride takes the van to go pick up the 2 that are in homeschool, co-op. And while she is driving, all of a sudden, because of construction over there off of I-10, she has to stop. They're doing freeway construction. And as she stopped with the 2 babies in the back seat, the second seat, she was impressed to look in the rearview mirror. And as she looks, she sees a bus, a school bus down the road. And then she heard a voice. Did you know the Holy Spirit speaks? And the Holy Spirit says, the bus will not stop. Move. And my little bride took that van, and she moved. She took the van, and you know how they have the orange barrels and barricades? She's moving and pushing them, driving them out of the way. And I know the people around her must think this woman's crazy, right? But just as she gets out of the way, the bus never stops. The bus just misses her, and the bus, with no brakes, crashes into the car that's in front of her, that crashes into the car that's in front of that car. So listen, the Holy Spirit will lead and guide us. If we will listen, the Holy Spirit will help keep us from danger that God doesn't want us to enter in. So when I hear something where the Holy Spirit's speaking, I want to be in tune to be able to hear the voice of the Holy Spirit. So when she asks, how could this be? The angel says, the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit will come upon you. The power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the baby born will be holy and will be called the Son of God. What's more, your relative Elizabeth has become pregnant in her old age. People used to say she was barren, but she's now in her 6th month, for nothing is impossible with God. Listen to what Mary said. First, nothing is impossible with God. So whatever your situation is, how many of you know with God, all things are possible, okay? And this is a great season. But I love her response. She says, I am the Lord's servant. May everything you have said about me come true. And then the angel left her. And the scripture says, she says, I'm the servant of the Most High. Be it unto me as you have spoken. And I wonder if that's our desire. If God comes and speaks something to you, instructs something, not just for you to do, but the work he wants to do in you. How many of you want to say, okay, Lord, your will be done in my life? That's your desire, right? I believe that's all our desire. And with God, nothing's impossible. So as I look at this story, as they read from Luke chapter 2, as they read from Matthew, look at some of the words that, because when she said this, you know, she's engaged, right? And could you imagine her telling, hey, Joseph, by the way, I'm pregnant. But it wasn't a man, it was the Holy Spirit. No, I'm okay, I'm a man, okay. I was like, all right, right. So that's why the scripture they read, the Lord comes to Joseph in a dream. He says, no, this is by the Holy Spirit. Watch this. And he says some things. He'll be Emmanuel. He'll be God with us. And watch this. And I love this. And he says, you will call his name Jesus, and he will save his people from their sins. So as I listen to the songs, as I listen to the scriptures, here's some of the things that come out to me. Number one is don't be afraid. Fear not. And I've learned something. When we truly know how much God loves us, when we receive the love of God, it says in 1 John, perfect love casts out all fear. All fear. Does anybody have fear? Have you ever had fear about relationships, finances, health, economy, the world? Listen, fear knocks on our door every day. So if I understand, I am so loved by God and I receive his perfect love, it will cast out all fear. So I want to walk in that kind of love. I want to know the Lord in such a way that I don't walk in fear. Because it's interesting, we can choose to walk by faith, knowing that nothing is impossible with God, or we can choose to walk by fear and let it rule and guide our lives. And it's a dark way to live. So I'm going to encourage you, before we leave this morning, we want to pray for us to receive the love of God and walk with no fear. Anybody? Has anybody have fear knock on your door? I was fearing when I told her, my bride, I was going to preach Christmas morning. I had fear of her response, okay? But thank God she's a godly bride, right? And I did my husband-daddy business this morning with the family. So God is good. So I see fear, and I love this. Peace on earth, goodwill towards men. How many of you know everybody wants peace? And listen, and Philippians 4 says, the peace of God will guard your heart and your mind. And so look at this, heart and mind. This is where we need peace. This is where fear attacks. Isn't it true? What are you thinking? So we want the peace of God. The peace of God only comes through the Christ child because Isaiah says he's the Prince of Peace. He's Jehovah Shalom. He's Yeshua Shalom. He's the Prince of Peace. So watch this. How important is peace? It's interesting that this is amazing to me. In Romans, watch this. It doesn't just talk about the peace of God. It talks about the God of peace. And listen to what Romans says. If you choose to be excellent in what is good, how many of y'all would choose to? Doesn't mean we're there yet. And I love this part. And innocent of evil, the scripture says the God of peace, the God of who? Say it again. The God of peace will soon crush Satan underneath your feet. Now, I don't know about you, but if I was writing the Bible, thank God I didn't, I thought, who's going to crush Satan? I would have thought this is the God of might, the God of power, the God of miracles. But isn't it interesting that the Holy Spirit writes to Paul in Romans and says it's the God of peace that crushes Satan underneath your feet? So if we will choose to receive and walk in peace, watch this. Did you know Satan can't touch you? He's crushed under your feet. Because the way Satan touches us is through deception, through lies. Because legally, he can't touch you. But how many of you know that's where the battle is? What do you think? Because in Isaiah 26, watch this. The scripture says that God will keep you in perfect peace because your mind is stayed on him, on the Lord, and you trust in him. So watch this. Because I'm preaching to myself. I'm going through some things, a lot of different areas, and I want to walk in that peace. But I've noticed, if my mind goes to the way of the problem or the situation, fear, worry, anxiety comes in and I start to react in a fleshly way. You know, whether it's anger, I know I'm the only one that's ever been there, okay? But watch this. And if I have to try, this is a daily thing, but if I choose to focus on the Lord himself, the Prince of Peace, Jesus, keep my mind stayed on him, watch this. The peace of God not only crushes Satan, but now instead of me reacting in my humanly fleshly way, now I respond by the Spirit of God. So instead of, you know, like this morning, I'm driving in with my bro, and I'm not used to driving in from Rosenberg. I came in direct. I said, oh, I got to turn there. And I put my blinker on because I got to turn, and there's another lane, and I don't know if this guy's going to let me by. And I'm trying to, and finally he stopped, so I went, and then he honks his horn. And, you know, I could have said, what's wrong? But both my brother and I, at the same time, we said, Merry Christmas, right? So we want to respond by the Spirit. Listen, if you got peace, Satan can't steal even, another word is your joy. Because he says it's joy to the world. I bring you tidings of great joy. And how many of you like joy? Even one of my daughters is named Hannah Joy. In our front yard, we got a sign that says joy, and there's a little manger scene in the middle, in the O. So watch how important joy is. Well, one thing Nehemiah says, the joy of the Lord is your strength. Do you ever need strength? We need strength every day. So watch this about joy. I remember working with some college students, teaching them, and someone interchanged happiness with joy, but they're not the same. And I just had this little, I said, happiness is based on happenings. If something good goes, I don't play, but if you win the lottery, you're probably pretty happy, at least for a season, okay? So, right, things go well, you're happy for that moment. Somebody brings you a gift, you're happy. But your happiness can, if it's based on happenings, how many of you know things happen that don't make you happy on a daily basis? But joy, they said, what does joy come from? And these words came out of my mouth. Joy is a fruit of the Spirit. So that joy will never leave you. And so joy is from within. So watch. If you're up and down emotionally with happiness and sadness, then it's not based on the Lord and the fruit of the Spirit, because joy, this story comes to my mind. I was raised in an amazing, godly Muslim home, beautiful Muslim home. And after I started college and I met people of different faiths and religions, I just questioned, God, why am I Muslim? Why do I believe what I believe? Why do they believe what and long story short, because you've heard it. So I cried out to Allah, to God. I said, God, I just want to know the truth. But not based on my family, religion, or tradition. I want you to show me. And without sharing my story, God showed me that the story we're reading about is true. That Jesus is the Messiah. Well, so when I received Christ, he not only changed my life, but it had an impact on my family. I brought great shame and dishonor to my family. So much so that it cost me. I had to leave my home. But God restored that in such a way that I was not only allowed to come back home. See, my dad had some restaurants, okay? And we were in Florida, and then we were in Houston, Texas. And anyway, things started going tough in Houston. And we came down to one restaurant left. And what's interesting, we lost our home. I can be real with you guys, right? Okay. We lost our home. We ended up in an apartment. We have this one restaurant. And we can tell it's going where eventually we'll lose that too. And we lost our last restaurant. And at the end of the month, we have to be out of the apartment. And thank God we had enough. My parents flew back to Jerusalem, where my dad was from. And I was the only one left at home at that time. My other children, brothers and sisters, were elsewhere, college or Air Force. And I literally had nothing left. I had enough clothes for one bag. And if you saw me, I had these green, I don't know if you know it, polyester jeans. These polyester, you know what but not the nice polyester now. And they were about 4 or 5 inches too short. And I had a white work shirt from the restaurant. So when I was wearing that, that meant all my other clothes were dirty, because that's the last thing I wore. So I had that on, and there was a laundromat. And I remember I had some quarters. I went and I washed my clothes, put them in the dryer, and I went for a walk. I left my clothes in my bag there at the laundromat. About an hour or so later, I came back to get my clothes. My clothes were gone, and my bag was gone. We just lost the apartment. I had no family, no place to live, no clothes, and no money. And it's just me with these green polyester jeans and this work shirt. And I said, okay, Lord. And the craziest thing happened. I don't know how to explain it. A joy came over me, and I started laughing because I so trusted God. I knew he was in control of my life. And I kind of sing and dance, and I started walking down, and it was over there by Wilcrest Murphy Road, and I started to walk back towards Houston Baptist University because I was going to school there. I had to sit out that semester because things were tough, but I'm headed that direction. So I'm walking down Bissonnette. I don't know if you know that street. I'm walking down Bissonnette, and I think of the story because my bro Don Yeager, will you wave in the back there? That's my Jesus bro Don. He and his bride lived in these apartment-type places, and they had just had their firstborn child. And I'm walking by, I stopped by to congratulate them, and I didn't tell them anything about my story. And as I started leaving, I know he won't remember this, he said, Salim, wait, I have something for you. And he went in the back, and he brought me two brand-new shorts, OP, he was a big-time surfer, OP surfing shorts. Well, he was married before me, so he got bigger earlier than me, okay? So these shorts didn't fit him, They fit me perfect. And I started laughing. I said, God, you're already providing, because I really needed clothes. Okay, so, but I shared that to say, joy comes from the Spirit of God. It's a fruit of the Spirit. So watch this. When you meet Christ, the Holy Spirit comes, and there's some fruit in there. Love, joy, peace. And we don't work it up, but we need to allow it to come out. So part of that, as we focus on Christ, as we focus on the kingdom of God, as our mind is stayed on him, there's peace, there's joy. And let me tell you something. When you start walking like that in this life, people see it. People want it. People need it. And it's one, if I just stand up here and say, oh, yeah, God is good, I'm so happy. Listen, no, there needs to be an outflow, an abundance of the life that God has promised in us. So as you, listen, as you focus on the thing, as you reach out, it's interesting. People notice if you're doing something because you have to or if you're doing something because you want to. And with the Spirit of God, you'll reach out and love people because there's a want to. God changes your want to. Amen? You know, so I look at these words, that don't fear, and the joy and the peace. And I love Emmanuel, God with us. That means he never leaves you. He never forsakes you. And I heard a preacher once. This is really good. He said, do you know the difference between never leaving and never forsaking? Because God, well, never leaving is, let's say husband and wife. Hopefully you can't relate to this, but unfortunately sometimes we can. So we choose that we're not going to leave. We're going to stay together. And so we stay together. But how many of us know that you can be there physically but not be there emotionally? Even for sometimes just a season. So you can be like emotionally divorced, and because of law, you stay there, but you're not. It's like two people living in the same house, but they never really know each other. Listen, the Lord himself will never leave you nor forsake you. You go through dark times, you go through issues, even when you fall and blow it. The Lord is not against you, he's for you. And let me tell you, one of the greatest names is Emmanuel, God with us. Because God will never leave you. God will never forsake you. And if you, like Peter, start to sink, if you just say, Lord, save me, he's right there. He's as close, where? In Deuteronomy, he says he's as close as your heart and your words, your lips. So listen, God never leaves you. He never forsakes you. But my favorite part is what God told Joseph when he said, man, I'm just going to quietly, you know, not be married to her and not say. And the Lord said, no, this is going to be the Son of the Most High. You'll call him Jesus, and he will save his people from their, from where? Their sins. Has anybody here ever sinned? Okay. The scripture says we've all sinned. Amen. So watch this, and with it fits the joy and the peace and no fear. And I know you've seen this before, but I thought this is Christmas, so this is the revelation that God gave to me. I was questioning, God, I want to know truth. I want to know who you are. I want to know, is there a true religion? Do all religions lead to, if you really just believe, does that make it true? Or is there real truth? Because, you know, I work with university students, and so many of them have their own private truth. If it's true to them, well, I've learned something. Truth is truth, period. If you don't believe in gravity, but you step off the roof, guess what? There's still gravity. No, isn't that true? So watch it. There is truth. And the revelation God showed me, and I know you've seen it, so I'll give you the short version, but it's such a picture. It's why Christ truly came, because in the beginning there was God who was holy and clothed in glory and righteous. Amen? And I need a volunteer. Do you want to volunteer? You look like a great volunteer. Thank you very much. Just come stand right here, brother. Praise God. Merry Christmas. So right here. So God says, let us create man in our own image, one after our likeness. So from the dust of the earth, God formed a perfect specimen, as you can see. Come on, give him a hand. And then God breathed, the man becomes a living being, a living soul. But why did God create man to begin with? Why did God create Adam, Eve, you, me? And I had my spiritual answers, but God showed me. Do you know why God actually created us? This is pretty awesome. God created us for this, for fellowship, for relationship. Actually, God is a daddy, and he wanted a family. Now, that was hard for the way I was raised to think that, this loving daddy created us for a loving relationship. So this is our purpose. Now, what's amazing, God has amazing plans for our lives, callings, and assignments. However, if we don't know our identity, we don't walk in our destiny. And you may be a hard worker. You may be may even do great and good things. However, until you know this, have this relationship, it's a work of flesh, and it's not an overflow of the Spirit of God. And there's a big difference, because one is eternal and one is not. So watch, because out of this relationship, what does God do with that, with Adam? He blessed him and he set him in the garden and gave him a job to replenish, multiply, subdue, take dominion. And you know the story. And he says, Adam, you can enjoy every fruit of the tree except from how many? One. Don't ever eat from that one tree, because the day you do, you shall surely die. Well, Adam and Eve disobeyed and they ate, but did they drop dead? God said that day they would die. Now, physical death started, but they didn't die physically that day. That very day they disobeyed, watch this, they died spiritually. They died in that relationship with God. And the scripture says that disobedience became sin. Okay, this is what Jesus, this is what the angel said. Became sin in the life of man. So watch, now there's no relationship with holy God. But this daddy God still loves us, still loves man. Okay? Even though we mess up. How many of you have children? How many of you love your children? When they messed up, how many of you still love your children? I mean, you want to beat them. I mean, you want to discipline them, but you still love them, right? So watch. So this daddy God still loves man, so he already had a plan. So he has a plan, but it's interesting. He sets up this plan all through the Word of God. And many of you know the story. Even Adam and Eve, when they sinned, immediately they covered themselves with the leaves of figs, remember? But then God replaced those fig leaves, and he covered them with something else. Does anybody know what he covered them with? The skin of animals. So there was some type of sacrifice, shedding of blood, for God to get these skins. And then remember when Abraham, God speaks to Abraham to go to the mountain to sacrifice his son. Remember that story? And just as Abraham was about to sacrifice his son, God sends an angel. He said, stop. But there still had to be a sacrifice. Does anybody remember what the sacrifice was? That's right. There was a ram in the thicket. So God's showing you not just sacrifice of blood, but there's a substitute sacrifice. And if you know the story of Moses and the Passover lamb, if you remember the death angel, the destroying angel, going to every home to kill the firstborn, but to separate God's people, they had to do something. They had to sacrifice a perfect lamb. Eat. What did they have to do with the blood from that lamb? Do you remember? That's right. If these were the doors of the home, look at this. They had to put the blood on the side and the top. And when the death angel came, if he saw the blood, the death angel would pass over. That's where Passover comes from. No blood, death. You know what's really interesting? As I looked at this, and I used to watch the Charlton Heston, the what was the name of that movie? The Great Commitment? Was it? Yes, Ben-Hur. And another one, the Ten Commandments. And then maybe you've seen the Prince of Egypt. But remember when the death angel came? If he saw the blood, he'd pass over. But what's interesting, I thought, what, the death angel never went in. They never looked inside the house. He never checked to see if they were Hebrew or Egyptian. He only checked to see if there was blood. So the Lord spoke to me. Listen, God doesn't look at your background. He doesn't look at your nationality. He doesn't even look at your sin or where you've been or what you've done. The final thing God will look at is the blood of the Lamb, the blood of the Lamb of God. And that's who Jesus came. He came as the Lamb. And so I'll bring out, it's my favorite part. It's the blood. Can you say the blood? So watch. After that, God sets up a sacrifice system. So when man sinned, particularly on the Day of Atonement, the high priest going to Holy of Holies, and he'd have to bring a perfect sacrifice. This is really important. It's interesting. When they went into that Holy of Holies, do you know that God judged the sacrifice? He didn't judge the man. He judged the sacrifice. And that's good news for you and me. And if God accepted that sacrifice, he would let that blood for a season. Look at this. He would allow to cover our sin. Why? Because now Daddy God can, don't worry, I won't do that again, brother, but I want you to see this. But I want you to see, look at the love that God has for you and me. He's Abba, Daddy, Father. This is what we were created for. And we chuckle inside because not only is he cute, but inside that's what every human being wants. They want this love relationship from Daddy God. That's why they hunt and hunger and pursue all kinds of things. Ecclesiastes says that when God made us, he put eternity in our hearts and our minds. And nothing can satisfy that except God himself. So man reaches, and it may be good things, but it may be addictions and alcohol and drugs and relationships. And they're never satisfied because the only thing that satisfies is God himself. This is what we were created for. So this Daddy God allowed this blood to cover our sin so he can continue this relationship. But man kept sinning, so man had to keep sacrificing. And then God, this is the wisdom and the mystery of God that he revealed a couple thousand years ago. It's a story we read. So one day God sends who? Jesus, who will save his people from his sins. Why? Because Jesus came not only as the Son of God, he came as the Lamb of God. And you read later on, he was crucified on the cross. We know the story. He was dead and buried, and he was raised from the dead. But sometimes we miss this, and it's very clear in the scripture. Actually, it's read a little further in the next chapter over, because John the Baptist is there preaching. Because the blood of Jesus, the Lamb of God, watch this. God took that blood, and he never does cover our sin. Because Jesus, the Lamb of God, doesn't cover. Jesus, the Lamb of God, what does he do? He takes away the sin of the world. Now watch. Why is there good news? Because there's bad news. Sin separated us from God. The good news is not only does God want to cover us with his blood, but you read in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 talking about Jesus, the one who knew no sin. This is awesome what he did. The one who knew no sin, Jesus, he actually became sin. That's religious mind can't receive that. That's only the Spirit of God can show you this. He actually became sin. But why did he become sin? 2 Corinthians 5:21 says that he who knew no sin became sin. Why? So that we might become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. There was a divine exchange. The wages of sin is death. We were supposed to die because of our sin. But God loved us so much, he took our sin, put it on his own son. That's amazing to me. I have 6 kids. I would not take your sin and put them on my son. But that's how much God loves you and me as a father. So he took our sin and put it on Christ. And actually, this is what's amazing. Look at this picture. Our sins, they've already been paid for. Actually, we've already been forgiven. The wages of sin is death, but the free gift. Now watch this, since it's Christmas. You see this picture? Eternal life, salvation, righteousness. God doesn't force it on anyone. Why? Because the scripture says the wages of sin is death, but the gift, the free gift, free gift of God, watch, is eternal life. So you see this? Eternal life, salvation, righteousness. God cannot force it on anyone. Why? Because it's a gift. And a gift must be received. A lot of us will give gifts, and a lot of us will receive gifts. Have you ever gotten a gift and you thought, I'm just going to package this back up and use it as a gift for someone else? Okay, oh, you're all guilty, right? Or you get one, you say, I want to go exchange this gift. Listen, so you choose whether you receive it or not. You may act like it in church, oh, I got it, but only you know if you take it really in your own life. So I want to ask you this question. Have you received this gift? Have you received eternal life? Have you received salvation? I'll say it like this. Have you received Jesus Christ? Have you accepted him as your Lord? It's a gift. He won't force it on you, but he offers it to the whole world. And those who choose to receive this, watch this. If you say yes, if you receive this gift, you receive eternal life, salvation, you actually become the righteousness of God. You become a child of God. You become God's son, God's daughter. And now Jesus became sin, but there was no sin in him. That's why when we celebrate on Easter, when he raises from the dead, he overcomes hell, sin, death, and the grave. And the scripture says, this is awesome, he seals eternal life. If Philippians 4 says, or Ephesians 4, we're sealed unto the day of redemption. I'll say it like this. When you truly believe on Christ, and we'll see what that means. How do you actually receive this gift? I'm going to show you in a moment. But when you do, when you receive, you believe, Jesus says that nobody can snatch you from my hand. Nobody can snatch you from my Father's hand. It's sealed. You can't lose it. And I love illustration. This is an American $20 bill. So how much is this worth? Say $20. Okay. How much is it worth now? $20. How much is it worth now? Yeah, it was sealed. You take it, Macy's would still take it, right? Okay, so watch this. So not only does our value not change, and not only does your value not change, when you blow it, when you sin, what's with such disgrace and shame, sometimes we struggle in our mind, or you know, and we may hear, you're a loser, you're a liar, you're a hypocrite, you're phony, you're really not saved. But in the eyes of God, not only are you still saved or God's child, watch, it's sealed. God's still your daddy. I have 6 kids. When they're disobedient, do I beat them and kick them and tear up their birth certificate, throw them out on the street? No, they're still my children. You got to get this picture. And God's a better daddy than me. So God's not out to get me. He's out to die, live, and pick me back up. You understand what I'm saying? So watch this. So it's sealed. This never changes. And when you understand the love that God has for you, that even when you blow it in your sin, you sin, watch this, you don't stay down. Now you get back up and repent because you realize this daddy God still loves me. See, that perfect love casts out all fear. I used to beat myself up. I gotta fast more. I gotta pray more. That doesn't accomplish anything as far as relationship goes. Now, it does affect fellowship, but God's still my daddy. You got that picture? You have to understand this picture, because once you understand that, when you blow and you sin, you're encouraged to repent and get back up, because I realize, hey, daddy God still loves me. Christ still took my sin, so I'm going to get back up and start living right. You understand what I'm saying? I used to try and live right and do right because I thought it made me right with God. No, because Christ paid the price, I am right, so I get up faster and easier because I know I'm already right and I want to live right for him. You understand that picture? So let me ask you this question. Have you actually personally received this gift of salvation? Have you made Jesus your Lord? And I'll say it like this. How do you receive this gift? How do you make Jesus your Lord? How do you believe this story we just read about the Christ child with not only good news, but he would save us from our sins? How do we accept? Do I just come to church, listen, and go? So, and I love this in Romans 10. This is great. Romans 10, 9, and watch it in these two words. These two words I'm about to tell you, they're pretty popular in most religions, but it's so powerful. And it's mouth and heart. Can y'all do me a favor? Can you say mouth and heart? And even the way I was raised, what was important is what I believed and what I spoke, what I prayed, what I said. So watch this. The Word of God says in Romans 10, if I confess with my mouth that Jesus is Lord, and I believe in my heart God raised him from the dead, the Bible says that I would now be saved. Well, what does that mean, saved? Watch this. Remember, save us from our sin. So what does say? It means I received the gift of salvation. So watch. When I believe that God raised Jesus from the dead and I confess with my mouth Jesus is Lord, look at this. I receive salvation. I receive eternal life. I become a child of God. It's sealed. It can never be stolen. So I'll say it like this. Once you really, truly believe and you pray, you accept that moment, you have eternal life. So in other words, if you drop dead this moment, you'd go straight to heaven. And that's good news. Amen. But I have more good news. Hopefully that won't happen this moment. Hopefully you won't drop dead right now, right? Why? Why do we, the moment we get saved, why does not God take us to heaven? because God has a plan for each and every one of our lives while we're here. God doesn't want to just take you to heaven. He wants to use your life to love people here and touch them for the kingdom of God in eternity. But listen, the only thing we're taking to heaven is people. So once you're ready for heaven, my car, my house, bank account, none of that's going to heaven. The only thing that's going is people. So why am I still here? Why are we still here? To touch people with the love of God, to share with them the good news, the gospel of Jesus Christ, in prayer and hope that the Holy Spirit will open their eyes to see that they too need this gift of salvation. Why? Because when I get to heaven, I don't want to be by myself. I hope there's billions behind because of the good news that I got to share. And let me share something with you. God doesn't care where you've been or what you've done. If you still have breath, it's amazing to me. If you keep reading and you read in the genealogy, God has murderers, adulterers, prostitutes. And I was raised, that's such shame and humility. But God is saying, no, I'm the one who can take even the evil and the evil choices you made, and I can turn it for good. In other words, God doesn't care so much where you've been. God cares where you are going. And if you make a decision even today for Christ, or even to repent if you already know the Lord, God takes you right from you where you are, and he starts to use you, not just to make you more like Jesus, but he'll use you to touch other people for the kingdom of God and for his glory. You know, the last thing I'll share, and then we'll pray. It's so interesting to me. In Acts, I wasn't planning to go there. Maybe it's 13, but Stephen is preaching, and he talks about David. And it's interesting that King Saul reigned 40 years, and then his crown was removed. And then and David reigned, and it actually says David, it's just interesting. God says, David will do everything I asked him to do, and David would serve his generation. In other words, David would finish the plan God has for his life. And David sinned greatly. David was an adulterer. David was a murderer. But he kept getting back up. So listen, God doesn't look at your past. He looks where you're going. That's great news. The greatest news is that Christ saved us from our sin. When you receive him, now you're a child of God. And great news now is that God still has a plan for our life, no matter where we've been or what we've done. Amen? So listen, this is Christmas morning. We're celebrating the birth of Christ. But let him be birthed alive in you. When you go out today, thank God for the gifts, but there's people that still need the greatest gift, the gift of life that's in Jesus Christ alone. Amen? Let's bow our heads and let's pray. Father, thank you for the love that you have sent to us, that you've lavished on us, that you have allowed us through your son Jesus to become your sons, your daughters, and you become our father. Father, that's the greatest news, that you took our sin and offer us the gift of salvation, righteousness, and eternal life if we just believe in our heart and confess with our mouth. And Lord, even once we receive that, we know that you've chosen us for such a time as this, to walk in this life, to let your light shine to this world. And Lord, we don't need to look back in our darkness or where we fell. We need to look forward and unto the Prince of Peace and where we get our joy from through Jesus alone, knowing that you've chosen us, even for now. And Lord, I don't know each one here. So under your breath, I'm going to give you an opportunity to receive this gift of salvation, to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, to make God your father, for God not to just walk with you, but now I didn't share the picture, but now when you say yes to Jesus, God comes to live inside of you. That's amazing to me that he calls you the temple of the Holy Spirit and the temple of God. So if you want that relationship with him, if you want eternal life to spend eternity with him, but you want him now to lead and guide you in this life, just pray this prayer under your breath. It's a gift. If you choose to pray this prayer, you will actually receive this gift and start this journey with the lover of your life and soul. And you can just pray just like that. Just pray it under your breath. Say, dear God, I know you created me. You created me for a love relationship with you. Yes, my sin separated us, but you love me so much. You sent your son, Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God. He not only lived a perfect life, But then he died on the cross and he paid for all of my sin. So God, I want to receive this gift now. So yes, Lord, I believe in my heart that you raised Jesus from the dead. And I will confess with my mouth, Jesus is Lord. Jesus, I repent of all my sin, and I make you the Lord of my life. So I receive you, Jesus, into my life. I receive your gift of salvation. I receive your gift of eternal life. And I receive your gift of righteousness. So God, you're now not just my God. You are my heavenly Father. Jesus, you are now my Lord, and I am saved. Now, Lord Jesus, I know I have eternal life. But, Lord, now I want your life with me on the earth. So I ask you now, Lord, fill me with your Spirit. Fill me with your Spirit and give me the power to know you, to love you, and to follow you. And, Lord, may you use my life to touch other lives with your perfect love that casts out all fear because of Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. And all of God's people said, amen. Praise God. Would you give my man a hand again for what he did? And I want you to see this picture. If you just prayed that prayer, or you had to pray that prayer, look how God sees you. You're his son, his daughter, and he'll never let you go. God bless you. Thank you. Merry Christmas.
Amen. So you see the praise and worship team back up. They're going to sing a few more songs. Before we do that, we're going to worship the Lord with our offering.
At one time, we too were foolish, disobedient, deceived, and enslaved by all kinds of passions and pleasures. We lived in malice and envy, being hated and hating one another. But when the kindness and the love of God, our Savior, appeared, he saved us, not because of righteous things we had done, but because of his mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ, our Savior, so that having been justified by his grace, we might become heirs, having the hope of eternal life.
The highest name of all, Alleluia. Here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. But for that very reason, I was shown mercy, so that in me, the worst of sinners, Christ Jesus might display his immense patience as an example for those who would believe in him and receive eternal life. Now to the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be glory and honor forever and ever. Amen.
Would you all stand up with me and sing together, Hark the Herald Angels Sing. Feel free to sing, clap, zavrit, whatever you want. Make a joyful noise to the Lord.
Let's sing together.
On earth and mercy, love.
Thank you.